Take your Bibles and turn with me to Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. Past week was a unique week, wasn't it?
Amen.
Many of you felt like that the Lord heard your prayers.
Amen.
And that He did a mighty work this week in our countries. Now, whether you agree or disagree with the outcome, I think it's safe to say that many Christians were bothered by this latest election in our country. We should be bothered more than just about elections. The direction by which our country is heading is one of division. I've never seen in my lifetime, I've never seen the hatred and division, the choosing of sides, if you will, that we see in America today. I've said for months and years now, the problem in America is not an economic problem. It is not a tax problem. It's not a leadership problem, really. It is a spiritual problem. The problem in America is that we have turned our back against God. We have forgotten the God that has birthed this nation. And that's not political, folks. That's spiritual. And so, this week, and even this morning, God woke me up with this sermon on my mind and reminded me of the times in the nation of Israel that God used national crisis, exile, captivity, destruction. God used national crisis to return the nation of Israel back to her God. I happen to think and believe this country was founded by God for God's purpose. I think it was founded to be a living testimony of the freedom that Christ can provide. I believe that it's a living picture of the mercy of Christ, the forgiveness of Christ. There is not a more forgiving country in this world than the United States. There's not a more gracious country in this world than the United States. All of the great characteristics of this country that you and I love, I believe, are founded in the Scripture. And it reflects the person of Jesus Christ. But when a country whose God is the Lord thy God, when you forsake Him and you turn your back to Him, you need revival. So this morning I want to preach out of Joel chapter 2, that great recipe, if you will, for revival. Would you stand with me in honor and reverence to the reading of God's Word? We'll begin in verse 15, and it's a long passage, but I'll stop it a little short. Verse 15, blow the trumpet in Zion. Consecrate a fast. Call a sacred assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders. Gather the children and the nursing babies. Let the bridegroom go out from his chamber and the bride from her dressing room. Let the priest who minister to the Lord weep between the porch and the altar. Let him say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not give your heritage to reproach. That the nation should rule over them. Why should they say among the people, where is their God? Father, we come to you in great praise and adoration of who you are today. And Father, I do sense a stirring of your spirit. I do sense the answer of so many prayers, Father. I pray, Father, that now you would awaken the church, that you would have us to step in and do our part. Father, begin a great revival beginning in this church, beginning with these people. Spread it throughout the nation, Father. Humble us and call us into right relationship with you. I pray, Father, that the word that you've given me today would not come back for me, but Father, it would accomplish the purpose and task by which you've given me. Father, I pray that great and mighty things will be done. And Father, we would not put our attention on any party or person, but Father, we'd look to the living God. And then, Father, that we would serve you as our King. Now, Father, speak to your people and change our lives. Is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. In the book of Joel, we see that there in chapter 1 is a massive invasion of locusts. They have caused destruction on the land. There has been economic hardships and devastation. The people, the kingdom of God has been separated. There is the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. There is great division and great divide. The theme for the book of Joel is the day of the Lord. Now, the day of the Lord there is symbolic of judgment from God to the people of God. And so we see that in this book, there is great destruction, great fear, great uncertainty, great hardships. And God is allowing those things to happen because of judgment on His people. There is much division and hatred and confusion and fear. Sounds like America today. We need a Joel revival, and I'm not talking about Joel Osteen. I'm talking about Joel from the book of the Bible. We need a Joel-type revival in America. I was thinking about this the other day. If we all, which I was amazed by the humility and the dependence of the church for this election. I mean, there were people posting on Facebook and standing in line getting ready to vote. People were saying things like, I'm going to go in and cast my vote, and I'm going to come out and pray. I'm going to pray and pray some more. I've never heard the word prayer mentioned so much in an election. We had a special time of prayer here at this church on Sunday night before the election. Everybody was saying, pray, pray, pray. Isn't it amazing that in times of division, of hardships, of uncertainty, and fear, that's when the church turns its dependency on Almighty God. Right. And the truth of the matter is, we're to live in that dependency, that great need of God every day, not just for an election, not just for making sure that our country goes the right way. I've got news for you. If our country's going to go the right way, it's going to have to begin with the Church of Jesus Christ. Judgment needs to come to the house of God. We need to repent of our sins. We need to ask God to cleanse us. We need to ask God to use our lives to win all of those people that are so full of hate and bitterness and anger because they're looking for a void to be filled in their life. And when it wasn't done through a political person, it needs to be done through God.
Amen.
That begins in the house of God. With the people of God.
Amen.
Joel had this same problem. Look what it says in verse number 15. I think what kind of revival we need. See if you agree with this. If you agree, I want to amen. We need a sweeping revival. We need to get everybody into how much division is in the Church of Jesus Christ for casting a vote one way or the other. There's bitterness and strife now in the church because you voted this way and I voted that way. Now we've got division. That's ridiculous.
Amen.
The body of Christ should stand together for the cause of Christ. I'm tired. I'm going to disconnect Facebook because I can't look at you anymore for the terrible things I hear the children of God say to one another. And then it's going on the cyberspace and everybody's seeing it. And so the world that needs to hear hope and needs to see unity and harmony, people that believe in somebody, we're divided. We need a sweeping revival. We need to get all of us. Look what he says in verse 15. Blow the trumpet of Zion. Let me tell you what I know about blowing the trumpet. It symbolizes and it means everybody come running. Just old country boy preaching to you this morning. When God said blow the trumpet, he had a word, he had a message. When the trumpet sound, everybody knew. Drop what you're doing. We need to stop what we're doing. God is about to do something. I wish I had time this morning to get Tyler to bring his trumpet in here. Toot the horn when Brother Sam preached. So that we would know this is an important message from God. He says, sound the trumpets in Zion, the city of God, the place of God. God has blown the trumpet. Hey, if anything, listen, church, if anything, God has sounded the horn. It's time for us to awake, get out of our comfort zones and complacency, and get back to the gospel truth of sharing the gospel with the lost world.
Amen.
Instead of picking political sides, there's only one king we'll all stand accountable to. And it's not a king in this country. It is where our citizenship lies, in the heavens. It is with the Lord Jesus Christ that will be judged. And so he says, blow the trumpet, consecrate a fast, which means a fast is the discipline of self-denial. Selfishness is destroying the church of Jesus Christ. If it doesn't fit into my schedule or my convenience, if it messes up my plans for what I'm going to do, I'm not going to be involved with the work of God. God's will must fit my time, my schedule, my convenience. Sharon told me the other night, I was at the house having a staff meeting and stopped Sharon and said, Sharon, how many people we got on the road? How many members of Woodhaven Baptist Church? Look what she told me. Dropping, Brother Sam, 400. What? 400? Where are they all at? What could God do with the body of Christ that had 400 members? Brother Sam, some sick. Yes, some are sick and aging. But some, can we be honest, are backslidden and forsaking of their God. And we don't want to confess it. We don't want to admit it. We don't want to consecrate the selfishness out of our life. We don't want to remove self. We just want God to appease us. Consecrate and fast. Horned. Horned blood. God said, oh, children of God, trust what you do. Did you notice he said the bridegroom? Listen, he's getting ready for his marriage. The bride is getting ready for her marriage. She's in the chamber getting all dialed up. Can I tell you out there, the tone wins. And if you walk in and talk to the bride and try what she was doing on her day, so she could serve the Lord that she would. Her mother, her sisters, her boys, everybody, man, you want the check? Are you kidding me? I'm not telling you what I'm doing. I'm going to do what I'm here for. I'm going to get married, get God said. The groom, drop what he's doing and leave the way. The bridesmaid, she doesn't even get finished dressing. She drops what she's doing and she rushes to the movement of God.
Man.
Oh, for people that would forget their selfish desires, their selfish needs, their selfish timetable, and drop whatever they're doing to experience a movement of the Holy God.
Amen. That's
what I'm saying. We need a sweeping revival. Now, he says in verse number 15 to call a sacred assembly. Sacred means holy. Brother Sam, I'm fed up with this idea in America today. You can live any way you want to, and God still honors that. You can do whatever you want, live the way you want. You can live your life full and trapped in sin, and God still is okay with that. My goodness, can we not remember when we gather together today, we're in the presence of a holy God? A God that has never committed sin. It's impossible for him to sin. He would never ever participate in sin. And you mean to tell me that God indwells us through the person of the Holy Spirit, and we can just run to sin and embrace sin and welcome sin? He doesn't that we celebrate sin. We justify it in the church. Don't preach on it. Preach on it. Got family members in that sin. You're being compassionate. You've been meaning spiritual, you've been hateful. We celebrate sin instead of being ashamed and broken and hurt and harmed because of what it does. I tell you what, the things I'm watching on TV and the things I'm hearing in America today, it breaks my heart that the fact that the reason people live that way is they're trapped. They're in bondage to sin. They can't help it. They live in sin. They're trapped by sin. And if the sin's not broken, if the sin, if they're not lifted up out of sin, you've not seen anything yet. And people laughing. People just concerned about what they see. People's like, well, we're all sinners. I sin, but I'm not a sinner. I'm a sinner saved by the redeeming love of Jesus Christ, who is holy and perfect and sinless. And he wants my life to reflect his life. Y'all are right. We ain't separate sin. We want God to deal with our sin. We're in the presence of God. God confronts our sin. Let's get back to common sin, what it is. Sin. We need to sweep it. Look what it says, verse 16. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders. Gather the children and the nursing babes. That the bridegroom go out from his chambers and the bride from her dressing room. And in other words, God says everybody needs revival. You're sitting here today. Look up here just real quick. Sit up here today. Look at me. Listen. There's a part of your life that's entangled in sin. You need revival. You need sanctification. You need God, a holy God, to confront you this morning. Your apathy, your coldness, your dryness to God in sin. Your inability to hear the voice of God anymore through conviction in sin. It means you're distant. You're backslidden. You're way away from the presence of a holy God. We need to gather everyone. Those that are backslidden, those that what would God do if all 400 showed up at one time? And we were in the holy presence of a holy God and was open to him confronting our sin and removing the deadness and the dryness, the waxing cold of our hearts, the distance because of our backsliding. And we said, God, draw us near. God, put us in the bosom of our God. God, make our heartbeat, your heartbeat again. Instead of just attending church. Just being there. I don't know about you, but I come today being in the presence of an all-knowing, all-powerful, all-knowing, everything God who confronts me. Call God is my witness as I was meditating, getting ready to pray, put you on this today. Well, God said, Sam, you need to walk and pray and repent of sin. I had to walk out in the parking lot while you was teaching. God said, you can't preach this with things in your life and things on your heart and things on your mind that are holy. We need to remove those things through confession and repentance. Cover them by the blood and mercy and grace of God. We need a sweeping revival that can change the lives of God's people. All of God's people, the children, the teenagers, the adults, the elders. We all need revival. Been my prayer this morning that God not miss any heart today, but that he get us all. Not only do we need a sweeping revival, we need a weeping revival. Look what it says in verse 17. Let the priests who minister to the Lord weep between the porch and the altar. Philippians says, spare your people, O God, O Lord, and do not give your heritage to reproach, that the nations should rule over them. Why should they say among the peoples, where is your God? Did you know there's half of our country that says there is no God? There's half of our country that's dependent on their traditions and their ideologies and their ideas. They're looking for answers for their life. That's why they're turning to politics. They're looking for someone else to fix their miserable lives. And I don't know about you, but I don't break the heart of the children of God. Those people are lost without Christ. They're lost. They're hopeless. They don't have a way to change their life. I'm not too far. Even if the person that they thought they would be in office, get in office, they still have miserable lives because they don't know Christ.
Amen.
Our hearts ought to be broken. Our hearts should be full of sadness and sorrow for what sin. You do realize sin is causing this problem. It is sin, the work of the devil, the enemy, that is bringing this deception, this pain, this suffering, this hurt. It is a spiritual problem. It can only be covered through the blood of Jesus Christ. It can only be overcome by the Spirit of the living God. You know what us Christians do now? We just complain and murmur, make fun of. Y'all are not. Those that we don't agree with and those that don't see things the way we see them, that's not what God gave us instruction to do. He did not tell us to persuade them to believe what we believe. He did not say to make them your friends and befriend them. He said, preach the gospel. Tell them the truth of God's love. Confront their sinfulness and reveal the holiness and righteousness of God. We need broken hearts. People who are disturbed by the lostness. And you just begin in your family. Anybody here got family members that are lost? If you just began in your family, hearts is wax cold. We no longer are saddened. I got news for you. The rapture may happen before I finish your message today. And it's going to be too late then for you to try to convince them, be friendly, and try to dance around the issue because you don't want to offend and hurt your feelings. You just don't want to go out and confront them and say, hey, if the rapture happened today, where are you going? No. If they're backslidden or forsaking God, you don't want to go to them and say, you need to repair your life and relationship. Jesus is coming. Oh, God will just take care of that. There's no more brokenness and sadness and sorrow in the church today for lost sinners or backslidden saints or forsaken saints. We're just waiting on God to do a miraculous work. I got news for you. God is doing that work. He's willing to do that work through you. I'm reminded that even the lost man, the rich man, that died and went to hell, was concerned about his family. Remember what he said? Send Lazarus. Resurrect Lazarus. Send Lazarus so that he can tell my lost brothers and sisters about God and Christ. So that they don't come to this miserable place that I am. Oh, we're a church full of people, the church of Jesus Christ, that have the heart of the lost rich man. Concerning lost people going to hell. What we need revival. We need a sweeping revival. We need a weeping revival. And in verses 18 through 32, we need a reaping revival. Let me read some of the things that God will provide in this revival. See if you or I need this morning. I ran down the list and God, if I'm missing any of this in my life, God, I need revival. I need it. Look what it says in verse 18. It's a reaping, which means it'll produce. Then the Lord will be zealous for its land and pity its people. But we need a revival of mercy. Mercy in the church. You know what mercy is? Mercy is God not giving you what you rightfully deserve. You know the attitude of the church today, right? Give them what they deserve, God. Send them all to hell. Judge them all, God. Well, do whatever to them, God. I tell you what, when you're having a reading, revival, people begin to show mercy. Now, it doesn't mean you explain away their sin, justify their sin, or agree with their sin. But what it means is you understand that the same God that they need is the same God that didn't give you what you deserve when you were in their shoes. Amen. Whole different way of looking at somebody's life and decisions, amen? When you look through it through the eyes of mercy. They may deserve all of that, but we need to show mercy. Verse 19, the Lord will answer and say to his people, behold, I will send you grain and new wine and oil, and you will be satisfied by them. I will no longer make you a reproach among nations. Not only will a reaping revival bring mercy, but it also brings newness, freshness. Newness, freshness. Look what God says. Behold, I will send you grain and new wine and oil. Now let's break it down. Grain because the locusts had destroyed the land and they were being war. There was a mass hunger issue, famine in the land. And so he's saying, I will send you, when I give you a revival that reaps forth the harvest, I'm going to give you new grain. In other words, I'll be your sustainer. I'll be the substance that sustains you. You will no longer depend on what the world can provide and what you can provide for you. I'll be your bread. I think Jesus referred to himself as the bread of life. And if you eat that bread, you'll never hunger again. And Jesus said here, the Bible says that when God sends a reaping revival, he gives mercy, but then he brings freshness and newness. You notice that phrase, new wine? That new wine, by the way, means non-alcoholic for all of you that may have a problem with that. Somebody right now is saying, I can drink a little glass of wine every once in a while. Yeah, you can if it's the new wine. You know what that means? It translates freshly squeezed from the vine. Which means that when I think about big old plump of the big old grapes and squeeze that thing, put it into a jar and drink. But Rob, you remember we went to Mexico and they brought them oranges off them trees and brought them right into them huts and then went and buried down on it and they mashed and mashed and mashed until they got enough to bring a pitcher full of orange juice out to us. I'm telling you, there was no sugar, there was nothing added to it. It was pure straight from the vine. That's the finest orange juice I've drank in my life. When God refers to the new wine, he's talking about creating in us freshness, newness. I have a question for you. When's the last time you got a fresh word from God? I mean, when the word of God leaped off the pages into your heart and God said, this is just for you. So he's smiling. He's got that new mind. He knows what I'm talking about. Got that new word for you, new direction, new purpose. He's speaking directly into your heart. It's like God is broken right from the pages. When's the last time you got one of those? That new mind. That oil is symbolic of anointing oil. Fresh anointing. I'm going to sound like a Pentecostal this morning. Amen. I tell you, you get some of Jesus, you get the Holy Ghost too. Amen. You get a little anointing. And that anointing means the freshness, the pouring out of God's Spirit on you. Y'all right? Well, we need some revival. We've got stale Christians living off the dead bread of years past.
Right.
instead of the freshness of the word that we got. We're going off on two things that we read about the old man, Monty. We're looking at all the things and saying, my God lives because of the old. I got new figures. Your God is brand new. His mercy and grace is fresh and new right now. Today it's new. Well, I don't feel that way. That's why you need a big revival. You need some freshness poured in. You need to be anointed by the Lord. We need mercy. We need newness and freshness. Verse 20. But I will remove far from you the Lord of mine and drive him away into a barren and desolate land. With his face toward the eastern sea and his back toward the western sea, his stench will come up and his foul odor will arise because he has done monstrous things. Now, verse 20 talks about a revival of overcoming our enemies. You know why we need a reaping revival? Is because the enemy has been stealing our fruit. See, I'm telling you right now, in Jesus' name, I repeat what I'm about to say. But there's some of you here today not receiving this word and won't receive revival because the devil steals your fruit. Every time God tries to put a fresh word into your life, every time he tries to pour a little anointing oil on you, every time you get right up to the edge where you say, God, breathe in me freshness and newness and mercy and grace, just when you get to that point, the devil allows something. The devil comes in to come, but your thinking flesh rises up.
That's right.
Every time you're around the prayer of God doing something miraculous and wonderful in your life, your way of prayer causes your fear, your disobedience, and the enemy snatches that word out of your life. I tell you what we need. I rebuke that, by the way, in the name of Jesus, in your life today. That song we sang, yeah, y'all put there, y'all miss all the emphasis behind the music. That song, open my eyes, Lord, and let open my ears, Lord. Hey, I'm telling you, when you come to church, God's got a word for you. God's going to do something in your life. God wants to, it's one-on-one time with you and Jesus. But if you're reading, you're depart from here today and not encounter the living God. The enemy is stealing from you, your flesh. The devil. The world. Man, I started mentioning politics, some of y'all turned me off. I ain't come here today. No, you didn't. You come here so you can hear revival. I pray the Lord take your hand and bind and cast me and throw me in the dry places that you might hear a word from him today.
Amen.
That his stench be uprooted from you. Amen. And I hope God keep blowing it further and further away. I'm telling you, we need to find the enemy in our life. God wants to send a revival where he can find that enemy and keep the stench and the destruction and the death of your enemy. Remove it and give you news of life. Man, I've got to hurry. Verse 21 through verse 24. I'm just going to read it to you because I can't give it all. Amen. I'll be here to tell you. Some of y'all just turned me off. We need a reaping revival. We need one of mercy and newness and freshness and overcoming our enemies. And then we need, according to verse 21 through 24, a revival of joy and praise. He said, fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done marvelous things. Do not be afraid, you beasts of the field, for the open pastures are springing up, and the tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and the vines yield their strength. Be glad then, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. And that's all. I mean, if I get any further than that, I'm going to have a cut down to spell. This is Brother Sam. I wonder how many times the Lord looks in on us and thinks, what phonies? What phonies? They say they've got their hearts full of joy and praise, but they got to have something to stir it up. They've forgotten that in the land. Remember now, when he's talking about the land rejoicing, man, here's what you got to remember. The locust done destroyed everything. It's barren. It's dry. Dead. There's no green grass. There's no green trees. There's nothing. The locust has destroyed it. And so here's what doctor said. Doctor said, although your life might be destructive and there may not be any greatness and freshness and newness there, you still need to rejoice and give Him praise. I think sometimes the only time we give genuine praise and worship is when everything's great. Everything's got to be green. All the fruit's got to be there before I can start praising and rejoicing. You know? I'm going to preach the book of James the first few years on Sunday nights. I'm going to do a Bible study. I love the book of James. James is known as the New Testament Proverbs. Read that book. Read that book. James says, as he starts the whole thing out, saying, count it all to faith in various trials and temptations. Right out of the gate. You think God knows something about us we don't want to admit to ourselves? We don't want to praise Him. We don't want to worship Him. We don't want to remember all the marvelous things He's done. How many of y'all know that the greatest miracle you've ever experienced in your life is salvation?
Amen.
That's the greatest miracle of all. How a loving God, a sinless God, a holy God could love somebody like me. How He could forgive somebody like me. How He could pardon somebody like me. How He could take my place on the cross. I deserved that. He didn't. And yet this God showed me mercy and grace and came into my life. Cleansed me, forgave me my sin. There's no greater miracle than the miracle of salvation.
Really?
Remember what He's done in your life. So people say, you don't know what I'm facing. Hey, I don't care for you what you're facing. You've got a God that's already saved you. A God that wants to bring you to salvation. That's worth celebrating over. That's worth having joy in your heart is that God providing salvation for you. That's worth giving you praise and honor and glory. If nothing else, is He can provide salvation for you. Boy, we need a revival of worship and praise. Amen. So when we don't put it on what the world says, it's got to be entertaining. It's got to get my flesh stirred up. It's not about your flesh. It's about what's in you, the Holy Ghost. He's the one ought to be doing cartwheels. He ought to be the one celebrating who He is. He knows who He is. Y'all all right? He don't have to be conjured up. He don't have to be worked up. He's already who He said He is. He is the holy, sinless Spirit of the living Christ. I'm going to go to that next one. Got a couple more. Alright. We got a revival of mercy, newness, freshness, overcoming our enemies, joy and praise. What about restoration? Luke verse 25. So I will restore to you the years that the swarming locusts have eaten up, the crawling locusts, the consuming locusts, and the chewing locusts. My great army which I sent among you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God who has dwelt wondrously with you. My people shall never be put to shame. I'm going to look up here. How many of y'all think you got some wasted years because of your sin and rebellion and disobedience to God? Let me see your hands now. Come on, bear witness to Jesus now. He already knew how. If I close my hands up, amen. Can I tell you something? When you have a revival of restoration, you know your God has forgiven you those sins. You know your God has washed those sins and cast those sins as far as the east is from the west. Never to be remembered anymore. He don't want your life focusing on the forgotten things, the things that you failed God in. He wants you to look at your life in a new light. The new land that He's created for you. Get out of your past and live in the present with God so you'll have a hope for the future. Quit whining about all your shortcomings as a lost person, all your sin as a failed child of God. Quit living in the past and have a revival of restoration. If you're living in wasted years right now, you feel like you're not doing anything for God, then confess and repent and restore the heal. Don't sit there and wallow in your failures. Do something about it. Crying and moaning, you need restoration. Let God speak to you. Let God confront you. and say, yeah, you've wasted some years. Yeah, you've thrown away some years because of your disobedience, your hardness, your dryness, all those things. But I'm here this morning bringing you new life. Bring you to your new life today. Restore to you. And I've got news for you. I'll make your tomorrow 5 times better than your failures of yesterday. You were wanting that stuff from yesterday, that's fine, but I got a whole lot more out here in the presence. Y'all all right? Let me get this last one. Verse 28. And it shall come to pass. By the way, that's an imperative phrase which means it's a covenant promise with God. Look at your neighbor and say, this is a promise. Now, God said it shall happen. And it shall come to pass after what? After the Holy Ghost begins to do revival in your life, a reaping revival. He said, that I will pour out my spirit. The word pour out means to pour empty out. Tell you something about God. God don't have an eyedropper with a little bit of the spirit dropping. Y'all right? Bless God, my God says, I'll pour out. Which means he's going to empty the vase. Another way to pour out. That I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. How many of y'all would like to have your sons and daughters walking with God in such a powerful way that they're proclaiming the power of God in their life?
Amen.
When you've got big money, you need to pour it out on you. Look at this. Your old man. Got any old man in here today? Shall dream dreams. Young men shall see visions. And also my maid servants and my men servants. I will pour out my spirit in those days. Now, we need a reaping revival of mercy, newness, overcoming enemies, joy, restoration. And here's the last one. A mighty work of the spirit in our life. Verse 28 speaks of a newfound power. Look up here. It's not newfound. It's the same power. It's the same power Jesus said in Acts 2, verse 38. He says, when I have sent the Holy Spirit, he shall come upon you with great power, dunamis. The power of the Holy Ghost does not change. Well, what changes? The power of you to receive by faith, believe by faith, the power that's in you, that is within you. You just give him freedom to do whatever he wants to do. Rather than it's not new, it's the same power. The newness is you desire, being zealous, being obedient, being trustworthy and faithful to allow the Spirit to just do what he's supposed to do. I believe I got power to cast out demons in Jesus' name. Y'all all right? I believe I can claim healing in Jesus' name. Oh, you going to be a faith healer? No, I'm going to tell you. Well, my Jesus heals me more than one man. Y'all all right? He may kill your body, but heal your spirit. You need it. Y'all all right? Y'all looking mean at me now. I believe I got that power. Do you know I believe I got the power to overcome every sin in my life? Not some other one, not just the one that I have, but every single one. I believe in the power. Let me tell you what you need, what I need. We need an old fashioned Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost is power. All working, powerful, mighty work of God in our lives today. Don't let us change this country and take it back to where God wants it to be. It's close to one with the Holy Ghost. not limiting the power by our unbelief, but believing our God can do all things. Some of y'all, look up in your kid now, you know who you are. The Holy Ghost tell me to say this, so you know who you are. Some of y'all went to that poll Tuesday and voted believing your God was going to honor your prayer. And when you walked out of that, you had a piece of the comments about it. You weren't surprised at all. We didn't even stay up to 3:30 in the morning to find out who won. You weren't there who won. We've been praying for you all the same God doing everything in your life that way every day, all the time. Yeah. 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 Instead, you're picking and choosing. I believe our God's in the miracle working business. It says in verse 30, I will show you wonders in the heavens and in the earth. Bloody fire and billows of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood. Before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. Of course, that's prophetic, making mention of the miraculous things that God will do before he returns. Verse 32 says, and it shall come to pass. Here's that promise again. Look at your neighbor and say, it's a promise. That whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Look up here. I believe that God had a sweetened revival in the Church of Jesus Christ today. I believe that God had a weeping revival where he worked brokenness and tenderness into our hearts. I believe that God had a reaping revival. He began to do all of these works in our lives again. I believe we can see the greatest spiritual awakening that America has ever seen in its history. I really believe that God can save the United States. They don't have to be revived. Let me tell you, Brother Sam, if I'm sitting here today, and I've never believed in this God, I've never accepted this God, I've got this uneasiness, this uncertainty of the future. I don't know what the future holds in store. I don't know where my life will go. I don't know what my life's going to be. And you're telling me, if I just believe in this God, if I just call on this God, if I believe these things about this God that you believe about this God, that this God will come into my life and save me, even though I may be a terrible, wretched person, I may be mean-spirited and kind and great, I may be all these things, you're telling me that this God will and can save me. That's exactly what I'm telling you. It's a promise. Now we get to that last one. Lord, I thank you for this one. And how it's served my life. I pray now for your people. That we be bound together in the holiness and righteousness of our God. Father, we're bound together in that right now. And Father, we must be willing to allow you to confront our hearts in sin. They may be here today, someone that never has called on the name of the Lord. That their life is void, their life is empty, they're searching, they're looking for peace within themselves. Father, I pray right now that the Holy Ghost will go to them and begin to compel them, stir them, bring them. So that verse 30, the fulfillment of your promise, they shall be saved, can come to pass. Father, we believe that you can work that great miracle here today in somebody's life. Father, we'll pray for the children. Father, we get cold, we get callous, we get dry and dead. And our former success with you, and there's no newness. We just fail. We pray right now that the Spirit of the Living God will begin to sweep through this church. Begin a weeping revival, Father. Bring brokenness. bring sadness, bring Father, conviction. Confirm us, Father, if we need to be revived, Father. I pray right now that the Spirit would begin to draw, to humble us. I pray for a reaping revival. Begin to change people. Pour out newness, freshness, mercy, restoration. Begin to revive us, Father. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. The head bowed down. God spoke to your heart this morning. Say, Brother Sam, I'm one of those that need revival. Right now, with your head bowed down, but you just lift up your hand. I want to pray for you. Amen. 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 Hands going up. All over the room, the people are saying, I need revival. I both saying what I need to do. Put your hands down. I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray that God break.